This video is sponsored by DeleteMe. Click the link in the description to get a very special offer for Arvin Ash viewers. Let's say you're driving a car going 100 kilometers per hour. Should be easy to see that your car has energy, the energy of movement. This is called kinetic energy. In classical physics, this is a simple formula, 1/2 mv squared, or 1/2 times the mass times velocity squared. And since you're sitting in that car, also moving at 100 kilometers per hour, you have energy too. If you weigh 80 kilograms, you can use the equation to find that your energy is equal to about 3.1 times 10 to the 4 joules. But did you know that the energy you have standing still on the ground, not moving at all, is more than 100 trillion times that? Over 6 times 10 to the 18 joules. How is this possible? Yes, I know what you're already thinking. I'm going to invoke E equals mc squared. Yeah, mass is the same as energy, so the energy is in my mass. You've heard this 1,000 times. You may have also heard that most of that mass is tied up in the form of energy within the nucleus of atoms. But have you ever thought about what that energy actually is? How and why is it in the nucleus? Is it due to movement? Is it due to forces acting on something? What exactly is the nature of this energy and why is it there? How is it that mass can be the same as this energy? If it's all energy, then is mass even a real thing? I'm going to ask how and why questions over and over again, like a child, until we get a final answer. And this will take us on a scientific and philosophical journey into the mind of the universe. Let's go on this journey together, coming up right now. An 80 kilogram person might weigh the same as this rock. Nothing's moving, so there's no kinetic energy. And there's no heat emanating from the rock that we can see. But they both have about the same amount of energy. So what's happening? Where is this energy? Well, it's in the mass. Where is this mass located? And where is the energy in this mass exactly? Let's answer the first question first. Then we'll answer the second question before we go even deeper. What we call the mass is made up of all the atoms in the rock. Almost all the mass of an atom, typically more than 99.99%, is located in its tiny center, in its nucleus, which makes up a tiny fraction of its overall volume. The rest is in the electrons that surround the atom, making up the rest of the volume. There are two sources of mass. The known mass of fundamental particles, that is, elementary particles, which is what everything in the universe is made up of, comes from their interaction with the Higgs field. You can think of this field as like an energy grid that is everywhere in the universe. The different elementary particles take different amounts of energy from this grid. The more energy they take, the more their mass. So for example, a down quark, which has a mass of 4.7 MeV, or mega electron volts, interacts more intensely and takes more energy from the Higgs field than an electron, which has a mass of about 0.5 MeV. Similarly, all elementary particles that have mass interact with the field to some degree. Why do some particles interact more with the Higgs field than others, causing them to have more mass? We don't know the answer to that. It just seems to be a fundamental property of different particle types. But not all particles interact with the Higgs field. Photons and gluons, which have no mass, do not interact with it. Neutrinos are a bit of a mystery. They don't seem to interact with the Higgs field, but experiments seem to indicate that they must have a very slight mass. We don't know why yet. That's another story for another day. The second source of mass lies in the nucleus of atoms. It is not contained in the mass of the elementary particles that make up the components of protons and neutrons, but in the energy keeping them together and keeping them from falling apart. What do I mean by this? Let's take the simplest nucleus, that of the hydrogen atom. The atom consists of just one proton, which is the nucleus, surrounded by one electron. The mass of this nucleus is about 938 MeV. I can also state this as one atomic mass unit, or in grams, it would be about 1.67 times 10 to the negative 24 grams. But to keep things consistent and less confusing, I'll state everything in terms of MeV. A proton is made up of two up quarks and one down quark. An up quark has a mass of about 2.2 MeV, and a down quark has a mass of about 4.7 MeV. So if we add up all the masses of each of these three component parts, we get a grand total of 9.1 MeV. This is only about 1% of the measured mass of the proton, 938 MeV. So where's the other 99% of the mass? We just demonstrated that the Higgs field is responsible for only about 1%. The remaining is still in the nucleus somewhere. How and where is the other 99% of the mass hidden? Before we get to that, did you know that your identity and personal information is not hidden? In fact, there are dozens of data brokers that sell your information like name, address, email, social media info, even property value, and a whole bunch of other stuff for profit. This is where DeleteMe, our sponsor, can help protect your privacy and reduce your risk of stalking, harassment, phishing, and identity theft. They'll remove your data from hundreds of data broker sites. I used their service recently to do just that because with my online presence, you can only imagine the risks I'm exposed to. These are just some of the sites they removed my information from. Just like me, you have the right to stay private and protect yourself. And with DeleteMe, you get the power to make it happen. You simply sign up online and they do all the work. And right now, Arvin Ash viewers can get 20% off a DeleteMe US consumer plan when you go to joindeleteme.com/ArvinAsh20 and use promo code ArvinAsh20. That's joindeleteme.com/ArvinAsh20 or code ArvinAsh20, or you can simply click the link in the description. Now back to the mystery of the hidden 99% of the mass. Now we're getting to the meat of our video. The 99% is due to the forces that keeps the quarks glued together inside the proton. What the heck am I talking about? There is a fundamental force of nature called the strong force that keeps these quarks bound together to form the proton nucleus. This force is mediated by gluons. We know that gluons are massless. So how are they responsible for so much mass? Well, gluons bind quarks together and both have a kind of charge called the color charge. This charge is how the strong force operates. It's somewhat analogous to an electrical charge, where a negatively charged electron, for example, surrounding a positively charged proton makes the atom neutral. With quarks, however, we're dealing with red, blue, and green color charges that combine to form a neutral color. Now, I want to point out that these are not literally optical colors, but we use the term color charge because this charge, metaphorically speaking, works similarly to the way red, blue, and green optical colors can combine to form a neutral or white color. The way the color charge works is that each quark's color is constantly changing. They exchange colors between each other. You'll notice that while the colors are always changing inside a proton or neutron, they change in such a way that the three combinations are consistently red, green, and blue to form neutral. This exchange of colors is mediated by gluons. That is, gluons carry a combination of color and anti-color charges such that they can change the colors of quarks. And it is this interaction, that is the constant exchange of colors between quarks, that keeps them bound together. Now you might ask, why does color exchange keep them bound? Well, that's a good question. This has to do with an idea called confinement. Essentially what this means is that a color charged particle cannot exist on its own. Quarks and gluons are color charged particles. All experiments have confirmed that free quarks and free gluons do not exist. They're always found bound to other quarks and gluons. Why? Because color charges exist in a way such that the combination of colors is always neutral. This need for the combination of charges to exist as neutral attracts red, blue, and green color charge particles to each other. Color charge particles can also exist as color anti-color pairs. So for example, a blue charged quark can exist with an anti-blue charged quark to also form a neutral color. This is similar to the way that in electromagnetism, a positively charged particle is always attracted to a negatively charged particle. If you're curious like a child, you might ask, why do colors have to combine to form neutral? Well, this just seems to be the way that color charges work, just like positive and negative electrical charges work. You could further ask, well, what is a color charge anyway? Well, it's a quantum number that helps us explain the behavior of some quantum particles. We can explain it using mathematics, specifically gauge theory, but fundamentally, what it really is, as in What is it about the particle that causes this strongly attractive behavior? We don't know. Just like we don't really know what a negative or positive electrical charge fundamentally is. It is just a property of some particles that helps us explain their behavior. But if you understand what I have said so far, then congratulations, you understand the essentials of quantum chromodynamics. It's the science of the way the strong force works to keep the quarks inside the nuclei of atoms tightly bound together. And it's this force that is responsible for 99% of the mass of an atom. Now the question is, how is this force creating mass? Well, to understand this, you have to realize that mass is really just bound energy. In other words, the rest mass of an object is its intrinsic energy content. It's a type of potential energy. Any form of energy contributes to the mass of a body, potential or kinetic. The nature of this energy doesn't matter. So for example, a compressed spring is a bit heavier than the same spring without the potential energy stored in its compression. A hot pan is heavier than the same pan when it's cold. A fully charged battery on your phone is slightly heavier than a dead battery. You won't notice this mass difference because at our scales, these energies contribute very little to the mass, but they're there. This might not even be measurable because you have to remember that mass equals energy over the speed of light squared. So any increase in energy is divided by a very large number. You can imagine that a few joules of extra energy are not going to make a huge contribution to the mass. The strong force that binds quarks together is a form of potential energy. It's called the strong force because it's more powerful than all the other fundamental forces, electromagnetism, the weak force, and gravity. So when you put three quarks together to create a proton or neutron, you end up binding up an enormous energy density in a small region of space. Now, any kind of energy bends space-time. In other words, it creates gravity. And so bounded energy, which we've defined as the mass of an object, creates gravity. It's the energy inside the object, that is, its intrinsic energy content, that really defines its mass. Interestingly, E equals mc squared never appeared in Einstein's famous 1905 paper. What appeared was m equals e over c squared. That is, mass is a measure of the energy content of a body. That's the important takeaway. Ultimately, 99% of the mass of objects comes from the energy of the gluons confining quarks inside the nuclei of atoms. They are massless particles, but when they are locked up in the confines of a proton or a neutron, their energy translates to mass. In general, any energy confined in one spot becomes a kind of rest energy of the object, which is what mass is. This is why a hot object is heavier than the same object when it's cold. One philosophical way to think of this is that the entire mass of the universe is nature's way to confine much of the vast energy of the universe in such a way as to make useful particles that can create things and ultimately create conscious living beings like us. The energy needed to keep color charged particles from existing freely by themselves is ultimately what most of the mass of the universe really is. And this strong force has resulted in life as we know it. Now, one thing that I didn't cover, which is related to the strong force, is the force that keeps protons and neutrons glued together inside the nucleus of larger atoms. This is usually referred to as the strong nuclear force, and it's distinct from the strong force, which keeps quarks glued together. This is also a form of potential energy and also makes up part of the mass of an atom. So let me cover that briefly here. As I described so far, the strong force mediated by the exchange of gluons holds charged quarks together inside a nucleon, that is a proton or a neutron. But if a quark is pulled out of a nucleon far enough, the potential energy created by that stretch is enough to create a new quark-antiquark pair. When this happens, the stretched quark drops back into the nucleon, but the quark-antiquark pair forms a short-lived new particle called a meson. This meson has a slightly longer range than a gluon, typically about the diameter of a nucleus. So it can be exchanged between nucleons as a force transmitter. This force transmitted by mesons in the nucleus is the strong nuclear force, and it holds protons together along with neutrons, against their electromagnetic repulsion. This force, or energy keeping the protons from flying apart, is also part of the mass of atoms. It is considered a residual effect of the strong force. In fact, it is this mass, that is the mass due to the strong nuclear force holding nucleons together, that is released as energy in a nuclear bomb. The mass due to the strong force holding quarks together is not the energy released in the bomb. So what you're seeing when you see pictures of a nuclear bomb is due to the strong nuclear force. If you found this video interesting, be sure to check out my detailed videos on quantum chromodynamics. I'll see you in the next video, my friend.